So this is just a little piece of that hierarchy showing how the terms are related to each other. So again, there's 45,000 of these terms in reality. These the terms are applied to genes by a process called annotation. So you have your relationship between a determinant gene, and so that's the chemistry of annotation, or what we call GOA. So for example, the gene RIM1 might have associated with this term chemical synaptic transcription. So obviously the gene ontology is very important why we use resource. There's literally tens of thousands of papers that use it. And so you know, in my lab we actually do biology to some extent. So we, you know, this is a little bit different than some projects in my lab, but it fits into the line of research where we're interested in how genomics results are interpreted. So the gene ontology is so widely used. It's something that we've discussed in a number of other publications related to gene network analysis, gene function prediction, and also in the context of enrichment analysis in a different way. But we're interested in taking a deeper look, especially given that one of the most popular uses of gene ontology, enrichment analysis, it hasn't been scrutinized that much. So the impetus for the work is that the gene ontology and the annotations on the gene ontology is to degree, it changes over time. So this is something that I find biologists don't actually realize, but to just get maybe all we do, you certainly know by the end of this talk. So just to give an example of two simple ways that the gene ontology changes over time, is an example for just the number of terms that are in the ontology. So back in 2002, there were only about 10,000 terms, and so you can see the rise up to 45,000 terms today. In terms of the number of genes that are annotated, so in a typical genome like Homo sapiens, back in 2002, there were only about 11,000 genes annotated, and so now almost all particular genes have at least one gene ontology term associated with them. So one of the things you'll notice in these plots, especially obvious here, is that there are little drops, large drops and increases. So this is a hint of the kind of dynamics that are going on in gene ontology and the annotations that we want to focus on. So the question is, of course, that yes, it changes over time, but does it actually make any difference for anything that anyone is doing? So that's the burning question. So if someone does an enrichment analysis today, will, you know, 5 years, 10 years from now, will it still be valid? And currently, there's no easy way, before we did this work, there was no easy way for anyone to evaluate this data. So this is, to introduce the database that we created called GoTrack, a web application. So conceptually, it's very simple. What we're doing is taking historical information that the gene ontology makes available, the ontology itself, and annotations. We have this as available easily for us to use for 9 model organisms, including human. We match these data together by date. We have to do some work to make sure that we don't lose track of gene identifiers, which is another thing that changes over time. So that's just the database. And then this is at a month resolution, so we have data at about every month. And so the web application allows you to use two main functionalities where you can track genes and terms, so how they change over time. I'll show you examples of those in a second, and also to track enrichment results. So I'll show you the web application just a little bit briefly, but I want to talk more about the data analysis that we did. So this is a screenshot for a typical gene showing the annotations history. So there's actually three plots here. Let's talk about one of them, which is the x-axis is time, so this is going back to 2001. To the current time. And this green line in this case is plotting the number of annotations that are made to this gene, ACTC1, so it's a cardiac actin. And so this you can see these decreases and increases over time, so terms are being removed and added, and you can compare this to the average for all human genes, so this is the species average. So this gene started out with this sort of typical number of annotations, and then at some point it started to get ahead, and now it currently has far more annotations than the average. So one of the I think cool features of the website is that you can drill into the details, and it's quite a rich database, especially if you're interested in gene ontology. Lots of those details won't be interesting to everybody, but you can compare time points to each other. So for example, if you're interested in this term apoptosis, you can click on it, and then one of the plots that you can it's indigenous, it's statistically significant. So what we used was a list of, I'm focusing on over 2,500 hit lists that come from actual publications. These are collected by a database that was started at the Broad Institute called MCAPB. So these are exactly the kinds of lists of genes that people run enrichment analysis on. In fact, many of the papers these lists come from that are used enrichment analysis. That's exactly what we want. And what's nice about it is that not only do we have some genes, but since they're tied to a publication, they have a date. And so the date of publication is when we imagine if we had done an enrichment analysis then, we call that T0. We want to compare that to results we get at some later time. Okay, so just very simple, conceptually that we're going to take the gene ontology from time point T0 that corresponds to the data publication. We're going to take it from a later date, I call it T now, and we do lots of dates, but just to keep it simple, we're just going to compare it to a current date, which was at the time we did this work earlier in 2002. We're going to hold the hit list constant, of course. And we're going to get enrichment results out, and then we're going to compare them somehow. So I mentioned that the need to have some kind of calibration. So the details are in the paper, but basically what we do is we define a null distribution for any comparison we want to do by taking a random pair of hit lists, which are also separated in time. And so the intuition here is that if you have enrichment results for two time points for one hit list that are as different as if they had come from two entirely different hit lists, that would tell you that things, your results are no longer significantly recognizable, if that makes sense. So we did this on all 2,500 of those hit lists I mentioned, so we did two kinds of analyses that I'll focus on. So the simplest thing to look at is just how many results were considered statistically significant in some set usable false discovery rates. So very typical. And so that's what's plotted here. So on this axis, this is on a log scale, is how many terms were significant. So each point is a hit list. How many were significant at time zero, the time of publication, compared to how many would be significant if you did the analysis now. And you can see there's in general a large increase. So the average goes up almost by over a factor of 5. So terms, hit list that gave us 20 terms whenever it was published would give us 100 grand. Okay, there's lots of variability. So this is one way that the results have obviously changed a lot. A lot of this is driven just by the fact that there's a lot more terms of the ontology now than there used to be. And also a lot more annotations. But we really care about more details about whether the results are telling you something different. If we're going to interpret that, the results of that enrichment analysis, are we going to tell a different story using it? So this is where that null distribution turns out to be useful. So here's the distribution of, you know, using a similar measure of semantic similarity, the Jaccard distance, and tested others that are in the paper, give us qualitatively similar results. So this is the distribution for our null. So the blue line is just the 95th quantile. So if we look at the actual hit list, so this is now all of the T0, T-now comparisons. These have quite a wide range of ages. We see that quite a few of them fall below and overlap with the null. So these are the ones that we would say have now lost their similarity. They're so dissimilar that we can't tell them from random results. But a lot of them have statistically significant higher similarity. If we break this down by windows of time, we see something that's very not surprising, is that the older the hit list is, the more the results change. So the orange line here is the most recent hit list that we tested. And so you can see they tend to have much higher similarities than the ones that are the oldest hit. So the overall correlation between age and similarity is about negative. But if you look at it in terms of just this arbitrary threshold, it's very much a sort of half glass, glass is half full, half empty kind of story. About half of the hit lists have similarities that are below the story is a bit more nuanced. So the problem is, it's hard to do this in a very objective way. So our objective analysis is using statistical similarity. But if you look at it subjectively, often a biologist will probably tell you that these two hit was separated by similarities. This is the case of an extreme case where the semantic similarity between T0 and T-now is zero. There's none of the terms are the same between the results for the two time points. But if you look at this, most biologists would say, well, there's actually a lot of similarity here. So I see, for example, that DNA replication is in the old results. Now, this one is about 13 years old. 13 years later, I get DNA replication initiation. And you know, it's a matter of opinion, maybe whether these lines should be there or not, maybe you want to add some more. But it's you know, just looking at these kind of results made us think that it's you know, even that the quantitative results also hide some of the qualitative nuances. So because of this variability that you can't really count on any one result being the same, if your opinion about what's considered the same is different from mine, that's fine. So we provide a tool that lets you do this on your own data. So this is a screenshot from that. You provide a hit list of genes that you paste in. Then you set some parameters and a reference time point that you want to compare to, which might have been, say, you published a couple of years ago, you want to see how the results change much. And you get these plots at the table. The plot shows you just the number of terms that are enriched at the threshold you set. So this is fairly typical, where you see, you know, back in the old days, you would have gotten nothing, and now you get over 300 terms. How significant. The semantic similarity measures are plotted here, so these quantitative measures. And the table, of course, is important to look at the actual results if you drill into the details here, and we provide some additional measures of stability. If you don't like this tool, is very simplistic, you can download the Gene Ontology annotations for whatever time points you want and plug them into your own different tool if you want to. So, in conclusion, initial results do change over time. A lot. How much this actually matters is very difficult to characterize. I think you have to do it on your own. I think the clear message is that you should be using the Gene Ontology in a sort of descriptive or exploratory way. Putting a lot of weight and results you get from it are, I would consider, very dangerous. So you can use GoTrack to judge for yourself, and I'll stop there and be happy to take any questions.
That's cool. So any questions? Okay. Question for me. Have you seen many people using this tool now and finding interesting stories that you didn't display as case studies?
I'm not aware. I mean, the tool came out a few weeks ago officially, so we haven't seen a lot of examples of people to my knowledge.
Yeah, this examples you've given.
Yeah, well, we spent a fair amount of time looking at different cases and trying to understand what makes sense and there's a lot of complexity for us. So, if anyone tries it and finds anything funny or interesting, I'd probably do it.
All right.
Good.
You showed this extreme case where the similarity is zero for something that arguably there are similarities. Would it make sense to maintain the migration association between terms?
Right. So the kind of times which genes are going to be. And so that's one of the semantic similarity measures that we provide, as well as based on the genes that are going to be. So you can access that to the website. We decided not to, so you can look at that and decide whether that, is it the same genes are the ones that are responsible for the entropy, you might say the deal, right? We didn't put that in the main paper because it's not a standard similarity measure. I thought reviewers, it's not very scientific, just make up a treating them as a gold standard is definitely dangerous. But we don't try to track that. That'd be pretty complicated. But I think through the tool, I don't know how much genome annotation you use for your project. But obviously, bird of paradise is not one of the Gene Ontology annotation for reference. You must have used chicken or something. So I think you may have balanced that. We do have data for it for sure. So you just have to have a look and see for yourself.